mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe it, and yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. And bodies are still being raised, and giants are still being slain. Yes, God, we believe it, and yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. We are here for
I worship you. worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. 'Cause you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. 'Cause you are waymaker, miracle worker,
promise keeper.
You are
light in the light
in the darkness,
my God. That is who you are.
You are here. Touching every heart, I worship you. I worship you. You are here, oh, healing every heart. I worship you.
Everybody, welcome to church this beautiful Sunday. It's so awesome that we can bring church into your homes. And welcome to the beautiful Mika.
Thank you, Mpo. Welcome to you too. And
Thank you so much.
To our VIPs. VIP means very important person to God and to us. It also means that you are a first-time visitor. So if you are joining us for the first time, please pop VIP in the comment section so that we can give you a warm welcome.
Yeah, and while you're commenting in the comment section, why don't you just take a moment and let us know where you're watching church from, whether it's from Benoni, Boxburg, Italy, Hungary, Spain, Netherlands, wherever in the world. It's so exciting for us to know where people are linking in from. When we gather as a church, we take communion after the sermon, so that you don't have to move around a lot. Why don't you get it now before the service starts, so that when the service starts, you have everything that you need for the service, whether it's bread, water, crackers, juice, whatever it is that will represent the body of Christ. Gather it now.
Speaking of people that I love, I absolutely love our senior pastor, Pastor Tara McCauley.
Come on,
coming
Pastor
to share
Tara.
With us, right, about gracious daughters. So, Mpo, shall we leave this to the ladies?
Yes. Welcome,
right.
Pastor Tara, as I leave.
Hello.
Yeah,
hello,
Pastor
guys.
T.
Hi, Mika. Mpo, where are you running off to?
Well, Pastor Tara, I thought I should leave you and Mika to chat about
this
gracious
daughter. You are so welcome,
though. Well, I was going to leave.
Guys, you are so welcome as well. You can also register
I was going to leave and go play golf.
Okay, Mpho. But you are welcome. Know that. Hi, everyone.
Welcome, Pastor
Thank Tara. You so much.
It is so good to have you join us in hosting this week. So last week, we announced that our Gracious Daughters event was going to be taking place towards the end of August.
Yes.
And we've asked Pastor Tara to come on and just share a bit about what's going to be happening.
Really Thank you, Mika. It's so good to be on the side of the service with you guys. We love watching you. You guys are amazing, by the way. So Gracious Daughters, everyone, is launching this weekend. Registrations have opened, Mika.
What?
Amazing.
Awesome.
So there's a website below. You need to log on there. Mm-hmm. And you can register. All you have to do is fill out your details and you are registered for the conference. We're going to keep you in the loop. It's for free. You can share it. You can invite your whole world to Gracious. It's going to be amazing.
That sounds amazing, Pastor Tara. And you know, usually we would have Gracious in our building. Yes. How are things going to work this time around?
Yeah, so it's really different this year, but we're rolling with it. We're going, okay, God, let's go. We're not going to let Corona or any virus stop what God wants to do this year. And God has a special, special word for His daughters. And we really believe that we're going to reach more people because it's online this year. So yeah. I really believe God's actually working and causing it to actually be a blessing so that everyone around the world can be a part of Gracious. How amazing is that?
That is absolutely amazing. And you mentioned something around a word. What is the theme?
The theme.
What is the theme for this year?
So the theme, I'm very excited about the theme this year because I really believe God gave us this word before this year started. And the theme is daughter with a voice. Before we went into 2020, He gave us the word daughter with a voice. We're like, okay, that's what it's going to be. God, you're going to use us. You're going to encourage us to use our voices to speak. Little did we know, we're all going to be walking around with masks on our face. So God knows. And God is actually saying, in the spirit, it is actually time for us to arise and speak, to speak the word, to speak the truth, to proclaim the gospel. It's not time to back down.
Oh, to speak life,
to speak life. Oh. So I am so excited about Gracious this year. Oh. I don't think it's going to be like any other Gracious we've ever had.
I think so too. Pastor Tara, thank you so much for coming
thank
to join
you.
Us.
Thank you for having
so
me.
Awesome.
And here comes our partner, your partner in crime.
Hey, now, so good to have you with
thank
us,
you.
Pastor
I'm actually
T.
quite enjoying it here.
But, please,
my
do
cue
stay.
To go. My cue to go. Bye, everyone. Enjoy the service.
Thanks, Pastor Tara. How awesome was that?
Oh, it's so great to always have our pastors engage with us. It's so awesome. I'm excited about Gracious. I even started following Gracious Daughters on Instagram and on Facebook. So why don't you do yourselves a favor and follow Gracious on Instagram and Facebook, and you'll keep up to date with all the announcements building up to the amazing conference at the end of August.
Well, I think like Pastor Tara said, you are welcome, Mpho. So, you know, welcome to the men, and everybody is welcome to go ahead and follow us online.
Amazing. Right? That is awesome. You know, speaking about stuff online this week, Pastor had on his heart that we should watch Vision Sunday sermon to remember the vision for 2020, mountain moving year.
That's
you know,
right.
So we're going to link into the sermon that Pastor Josh preached on the 26th of Jan, our Vision Sunday, and we're going to hear what the vision, be reminded of what the vision of 2020 is. You know, I mean, Mika, the year's not over. 2020
is not over.
It's still mountain moving.
It's still mountain moving. And I just want to say, you know, you might be feeling stuck at home in lockdown, sick, wondering, confused. I got to remind you that we have already started moving mountains.
Yeah, come
on. We have fed 500,000 people.
Yes.
We have 98 countries joining us every Sunday.
Come on. Yes.
We have received hundreds of testimonies, hundreds of salvations. We have already moved the mountain.
Come on. And also, why don't you just take a moment right now before we link into worship?
Right.
Why don't you move couches, move anything that might be hindering you in experiencing this beautiful Sunday? We are going to be worshiping the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords,
Amen.
That every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that 2020 is still a mountain moving year. So let's take a moment, move whatever might be hindering you right now in worshiping the King of Kings, the
That's
Lord of
right.
Lords today. Come, let's engage in worship today and have an awesome time in the presence of God.
Come on, let's sing people. People, come together. Strangers, neighbors, our blood is one. Children of generations, of every nation, of kingdom come. So don't let your heart be troubled. Hold your head up high, don't fear no evil, and fix your eyes on this one true. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Whoa, 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 whoa. Come on, let's sing that again. Today, Jesus, our redemption, our salvation is in His blood. Oh, Jesus, light of heaven, friend forever, His kingdom comes. So don't let your heart be trouble. Hold your head up high, don't fear no evil. And fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Swing wide,
so swing wide, all ye heavens. Let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All His children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus.
Oh, swing wide, so swing wide, all ye heavens. Let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All these children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Swing wide, so swing wide. Everything with breath, repeat the sound. All these children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Whoa, 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 creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All these children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Come on, let's sing Jesus. Sing Jesus. Our redemption, our salvation is in His blood. Oh, sing Jesus, light of heaven, friend forever, His kingdom come.
Our God is strong in battle. Our God can never fail. Through Him all chains are broken. In Him the sick are healed. In the name of Jesus, giants are defeated. Every single mountain has to move. You're faithful to Your promise. You finish what You start. There is none as powerful as You, Jesus. Jesus, we see You. We see the power of heaven. Setting the captives free. We are the church awake, singing in victory. In the name of Jesus, giants are defeated. Every single mountain has to move. You start. There is none.
Jesus Christ, Father, we thank you today. We're going to have a great time in your presence as we gather around the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We believe lives will be changed. People will be set free. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, church, welcome to Redemption Church. I know you're going to be so blessed today. Today, we're doing something that I believe is really going to touch you. In January this year, January the 26th, I shared what I felt was the word from God for this year for our church. And I actually never foresaw where we were headed in the natural. But the word was mountain move, that this year we would see God move mountains in our lives. And right now, I actually think it's more pertinent than ever to go back to the word God spoke over 2020 for our church, take you there, and actually, almost with goosebumps, you'll hear how God was speaking to us now back then. Let's go back there and feed on that word, fill our faith, and realize God is with us and mountains will move this year in Jesus' name. So our theme for the year is an awesome one. Our theme God gave me a while ago and has revealed that this is so on and spot on, is that God is taking us into season. And of course, all of God's word is true. All of God's word is relevant. But God also speaks for us words for now. And it is confirmation, right? The word of God is always, prophecy is always edifying. It never contradicts the word. But we are going into a season where I believe for our church, it's a mountain moving season. Okay? Mountain moving. And what's awesome about God is it's not about just the church. It is about mountain moving in your personal body, like as singular as you can get with that word, for yourself, for your literal self, your literal body, your literal life, mind, thoughts, feelings, emotions, cells, organs, mountain move. For your home, where you live, mountain move. This is not a year where God says, what mountain? So if you're here today and you have a mountain, right? A real mountain. Come on, a mountain isn't a pebble, right? Hey, the word for this year is it moves, yeah. Right? And what's interesting is I never had the scripture until I just got up to preach. Also in the first service, but I never studied this out yet. So just before I got to speech, this popped up in me, all your ways acknowledge him, because God wants you to lay down leading yourself this year. Lay down self-leading. Lay down emotion leading, feelings leading. You know how often Tara and I will argue and I type a long letter? Right? Right? But it's flesh. Right? You know how often we get a long email or a long phone call? How I feel. Right? That, right? It's flesh. It's cool because we all live with this. Okay? But it ain't going to deliver the dream. It isn't going to move the mountain. Right? And so I just felt like it's so important that even when we face a mountain, even when we face a hurt, even when we face a situation that we go, Lord God, my marriage, my finances, my health, my wholeness, my life, my meaning, my peace. It's a mountain, right? Right? We have to lay down that we can anybody here move a mountain in their own strength? Anybody who raises their hand, I'll pray for you after the service. You cannot do it. It's a mountain because it's bigger than you. It exists. It's existed longer than you. It's there, right? And people want to say, no, accept the mountain. And that's just life. No, God says, no, I want to move mountains and we'll show you scripture. But then studying this, I said all that to say this. How cool is this? He shall direct your paths. Do you know in the Greek what that also means? He will make your path flat. In other words, it had an obstacle and he flattens it, right? So I was like, wow, Lord, it's a mountain moving scripture. It's an obstacle squashing scripture, okay? And that is what God has for us. We're in we're in such an exciting time. It's so amazing to be alive. The world is getting darker and darker and darker, yes. And the church gets brighter. You get brighter. You shine brighter. You look better in 2020 by the grace of God than you ever did. You know, one of the things I notice about
people who are, how the Lord works in people's lives. Can I tell you something? All of you that I know, right? If I was to look at your marriage photos, you know what I see? The ladies, hey, they get younger and younger and younger. They look the same or younger than they did on their wedding day, and often better, depending on the fashion of the time and the quality of all of that stuff. And the second thing is the guys, you get more handsome. And you know what? Hey, 2020, we get brighter and brighter and brighter. Amen. When we go out there into our lives, into our working places, into wherever it is we interact with society outside of the local church, wherever it is, you just get brighter and brighter and brighter. Yes, the world gets more stressed. Yes, the world gets more lost, but that is a promise of what it is to live under the flesh, under your own path. That's what it is, the sign of the times as the day approaches. But we, the church, get brighter and brighter and brighter in Jesus' name. I receive that for me, right? And so 2020 is such an interesting thing because we can't get away from the number 20. And studying this out, I started to see some pretty cool things. And so hang around the next few weeks, you're going to hear a lot. First and foremost, 20 has a very specific meaning in Scripture. 20 means redemption. Should I say it again? 20 in Scripture means redemption. Oh, okay, I'll get excited about that. So, it is the official year of double redemption, right? I mean, we've literally seen this happen. God's birthed two churches called Redemption. We have two churches in two nations. Literally, that has recently happened. But even beyond that, do you know that the Hebrew calendar is the number 5780? That is the year in the Hebrew calendar. Do you know if you add 5 to 7 to 8 to 0, what do you get? 20. People, I pray for your math skills. Right? 20. Next year in Hebrew calendar, 5, 7, 8, 1. What does that equal? What is next year? 2020? Okay, as far as I'm aware, this is a very significant time because it is possibly one of the only times in history the Gregorian calendar and the Hebrew calendar line up year by year by year by year for the next decade. There is alignment happening supernaturally. What is the theme? Redemption. Now, it's not egotistical to say our church named Redemption is the only church God's interested. No, I'm not saying that at all. It is a season where the emphasis is the word redemption. And what is the word redemption? The ministry, right? The ministry of Jesus. Because redemption is better than new. Because new, right? I'm going to do my best to get this to drop with you. New means nothing went wrong. But redemption means anything could have gone wrong, but I made it better than new. I don't want to be, right, living life with the perspective that it goes well, but that is as long as it goes perfect. Redemption says, there is no plan B with God. With God, it's always plan A. Right? With God, it supernaturally goes better than I thought. God can even use, right, things that seem like it didn't go well. In the end, God can use it for His glory. That all things, see, redemption says, if I'm in a marriage where I see the fruit and the language is, it's a season of redemption. It doesn't mean we've been married and it's gone well because neither of us has disappointed each other. Neither of us has made a mistake. Neither of us has failed each other. Redemption says, yes, those things happened, but by the grace of God, it is better than it's ever been. I take this even further. Yes, Lord, we are planted in a local church in South Africa, in Africa, in the Netherlands, in Europe. Because I love the fact that you turn on the news, and I'm not speaking by my flesh, but my spirit loves the fact that you turn on the news and you hear what you hear. Because redemption means give me the broken stuff. Give me the stuff that doesn't satisfy the flesh and watch me work. Watch, the Lord says, watch me work. Watch what redemption gives ultimate faith because it doesn't speak about it's brand new. Even the world accepts that if it's brand new, it goes well until. No. Even if it doesn't go according to plan, even if it got tough, even if it seems impossible, God works. So we're in a season of redemption, 2020. Redemption in scripture is so powerful and then under the number 20, it's so specific. Do you know, for example, the phrase milk and honey is mentioned in scripture 20 times. When we talk about the land of milk and honey, what are we referring to? A promised land. We've spoken about the promised land in this church a lot for obvious reasons and spiritually significant reasons, right? Obvious reasons. I was named Joshua before I was born. And I didn't name myself for obvious reasons. The promised land is an incredible promise. It is a land that is attained not by works, but by rest. It is a land we don't fight for, but our Lord fights for. It is a land where we live in homes we didn't build. We eat food we didn't, crops we didn't sow, right? Grapes. But how many of you know there is giants? Right? How many of you know a promised land is on the other side of a Jericho battle? And a lot of people see the promises, but they see the problems. They see the huge giants, right? But a promised land, the great thing about it is God wants to give it to us and he determines it to us. And milk and honey is what's used to describe that. But 20 times is how many times it's mentioned. In fact, just for you right now, Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 through 15, right? Joshua has an interaction when he is at Jericho. He lifts his eyes, he looks and beholds a man stood opposite him with a sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and says to him, are you for us or for our adversaries? So he said, no, but as a commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. Joshua fell on his face to the earth, worshiped and said to him, what does my Lord say to his servant? He says, take off your foot. The place where you stand is holy. Joshua does so. So I wanted to say, prior to a battle where the promised land is delivered, Joshua has an interaction, right, with the Lord. The Lord, right? And at that interaction, he comes with a human question, a fleshly question, a feeling question. And do you know what that question is? Hey, whose side are you on? Do you know how often we ask this question in our lives? We go to people, whose side are you on? When we have a disagreement, when we have a difficulty, we go to God and we say, whose side are you on? Mine or theirs? Whose side are you on? Right? How often do we go and we ask someone for advice? But what we really mean is side with me. I'm speaking to myself. The greater question for a revelation that leads to you walking into your promised land is God is not on any individual side. He is on his own side. And he's given you his word and his Holy Spirit right? So that you can be on his side. So that you can walk with him fighting for you. When I'm bringing it to my life so that no one here thinks I'm preaching to them. Right? If Tara and I argue, the question is not God who's right. The question is the way I'm handling this lining up with your word? That's what God would answer. God would not say, Tara's right or you're wrong. He would say, hey, what would my word ask you to do? And that's where you would know where I would, that's what I would tell you to do. That's where the favor is, right? So walking into your promised land, seeing it delivered to you, is not the question, hey, what about me? The question is, Lord, where would you position yourself? Amen. What would he have you do? Yeah, but now, you know, that's hard. Yeah, it's very hard for the flesh. It's terrible. Flesh hates it. Flesh is screaming. Flesh does not like it. But God wants you to trust him. Why? Because he wants you to see the promised land be delivered, your mountain move. God only has your best at the center of his actions, your fruitfulness at the center of his plan. But the devil comes and says, hey, no, this is about sides, right? This is all about who's right, who's wrong. Who's right, who's wrong. Who's entitled, who's not entitled. What do you feel? What is that? But the Lord says, no, just line up with my word. That's all that matters. Amen? And so, as we go into this mountain moving space and we look into this, we look at the number 20 in scripture, just some cool things. The number 20 is how long it took the Temple of Solomon to be built, 20 years, right? Very, very cool. Pastor Prince is preaching all on the Temple of Solomon at the moment. It'll greatly bless you. Great revelation. Great revelation. Bless you like crazy. Blessing me like crazy. 20 years is how long it took the Ark of the Covenant to get back into Jerusalem. So we see how redemption, 20 times. And I believe with all my heart, it is a season to flow with God. It is a season for redemption is his signature, right? And God's plan is completely that your life is not defined by what happened in the last whatever, right? That is not, no, we go by, it is the season, it is the time. Right now, you could leave this building and you could, we are in South Africa, I'm preaching in Johannesburg right now, and it is outside 30 odd degrees in the sun or more, who knows? You could go out there and say, it is the season that is winter. It is the season that is winter. It's winter, it's winter, it's winter. You tell all your friends it's winter and you can dress for winter. You're not going to change the season. And it's awful to live life not going with the seasons. And so the good news is it's a season. It is a season. Redemption is highlighted. Redemption is highlighted. What in your life right now is fraught with disappointment? Is just, oh my goodness, it's just absolutely beyond. God doesn't say get a new, God says watch me work. In fact, Tara and I are gonna be doing, we never told the first service this anyways, we'll be doing something on marriages soon. And this is not because we are experts, but because we've seen God turn water into wine. And that's redemption. So I love that God says, give me water. He doesn't say, give me wine and I'll make it nicer wine, right? He doesn't say, what mountain? He says, let's move. Let's move it. Let's do a supernatural work in this, right? So in Zechariah chapter 4, verses 6 through 10, this core passage of scripture that I spoke to me and felt to me like it's significant for our church was, God says, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might, nor by power, but my spirit, says the Lord. Who are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you shall become a plain,
And he shall bring forth the capstone with shouts of grace, grace to it. The context of this passage of scripture is Zerubbabel felt the call of God to rebuild the temple. But the circumstances of building the temple were impossible. And God came to speak prophetically over him and say, let me tell you, Zerubbabel, you can build the temple and you will build the temple and you will see this mountain move with shouts of grace, grace. God wants our language to be all about Jesus's work. Jesus's word. What does the gospel say about a circumstance? Not what do we say, not what does human understanding say. We don't shout, fire, fire, it's going, we're finished, it's over. We speak supply. We speak grace. Jesus's work. Amen? The gospel of Jesus Christ is what we shout, what we declare, what we say. But what are our hands busy with? Building the temple. What are our hearts connected to? Right? Being a part of seeing this awesome call of God to be a part of something that is making an eternal difference. The bride of Christ. Not that this is the only church, but that does not mean be disconnected from the church. Whoever's watching, whoever's listening, wherever you live, get involved in your local church that preaches the good news of the gospel of Jesus and say, I want to be a part of this, because mountains get in the way of what God wants to do in your life. The devil does not care at all what you drive, what you earn, where you live. He cares that he comes against you walking in the calling of God on your life. He first tries to stop you from believing on Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And once that has taken place, he tries to stop you from living in obedience to the call of God in your life, following the Holy Spirit, trusting on the Lord, right? So Zerubbabel is given this great promise, this great declaration, but his hands are busy connected to the work of God. The work of God. Don't wait for mountains to move before you get involved in what God wants to do in your life. Oh, Pastor, you don't know what a mess I am. I could never, ever, ever, I could never be a part of church. No, no, no. Become a part of church and trust that God handles the mountains, right? Connect. Don't wait to be perfect. Listen, we will never be good enough for God to use us, right? But God still wants to use you. He wants you connected. He wants to be a vessel flowing through you. So he says, with shouts of great grace, 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 double redemption, double declaration, right? Repeat yourself. Say it twice, right? In Jesus' name, this is what he declares over my body. Let me say it again so that everything in me can hear it again. Grace, grace to the mountain. Right? His desire is totally to move your mountain as you declare the goodness and the grace through the gospel of our Lord and Savior. We're in a prophetic season that I'll get to over the next few weeks, but got me really excited, really, really excited, because I often ask myself the question, Lord, I just want to be following the Lord with my life. I need God to show me in scripture. I want you to know, I think my opinion is okay. I think your opinion is okay. But I really often, we started this church before there was people here. We started this church as scripture and the Lord has led us, right? And so I really need the Lord to speak to me. And I have been inundated the past few days with God speaking over this season in our church by his word. And one of the most exciting things is we are in the season of a great catch. Simply put, the Church of Jesus Christ is exploding. Right? It is in the season of redemption. Right? The nets are cast into the ocean. And the ocean is always a picture in Scripture of the Gentiles. Right? There's three groups of people in Scripture. Jew, right? Gentile, and church. Okay? Jew, Gentile, and church. Right? And when you want to look at the picture for Gentile, it's the ocean. It's the sea. Jesus says to Peter, hey, follow me. I will make you fishers of men. Right? The oceans speak for so many things that it's about the Gentiles. Jesus speaks and he says in Matthew chapter 13, a whole bunch of parables. There's a whole bunch of things going on here. Right? And we'll get to it. But fundamentally, he deals with the field, he deals with the pearl, and then he deals, right, with the net. The field speaks to Israel, the pearl speaks to the church, and the net speaks to the lost. As we preach the gospel of the finished work of Jesus, right, the nets fill up like crazy, right? The catch is huge. When we even think of the rapture, the Bible tells us that, right, the longer the delay, it's not because of us, it's because of the lost. God loves all, including the lost. I remember when we lost Joel's here in this service. We lost him in a mall, a very busy mall, shopping center, a few years back for quite a long time. I don't know if he really remembers it, but Tara and I were very, very traumatized because we lost him for a long time. It wasn't 10 seconds. And there's such a dark world. Children are such an object of such horrible things. And so we started to panic because he was gone from our sight. What had happened was he had wandered off, and long story short is he was lost. And we started to really panic. There had been a child abduction in this mall a few months earlier that was all over the news and stuff. And we started to freak out, and I started to run from person to person. And we at the time had, he's our second child, so we already had Jonathan. And I remember panicking and being distraught. And Tara was running over there, and I'm here, and we're running, and we're splitting up to find. And I would have been incredibly disturbed if someone had said to me, but you still have another child. Why are you so distraught over the one who's lost? And God has such a heart for the lost too. You were at one point lost. And he so wants us to reach, to preach. He so wants us to join in the joy of that. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, right? We've spoken about this in church before, verse 7. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Our life is not by what we see, what we think, what we feel, but by we trust in obedience to God's word. Lean not on your own understanding. Peter could have said, Jesus, I'll come and walk on the water. You know what what I would have seen is Jesus goes, and concrete goes from his hand on a travelator and makes a path for Peter to walk. Because you can't walk on water. We're going to throw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the fire. My God goes, and water, and the fire's gone. Come on. There's my ways. So even now when I'm talking about mountain move, don't start thinking how. He's going to move it. except through your obedience to his word and his ways, following the Holy Spirit. Pastor Prince has been hitting on this lately. Jesus doesn't say to the man with the withered hand, hide it away and I'll heal it. He says, stretch it forward. The whole essence of stretching forward a withered hand is you have nothing to stretch. Oh, but Jesus, you're embarrassing him. You're embarrassing him. It's very uncomfortable. Jesus is like, no. In faith, respond. So I have healing for you. Jesus doesn't say to the lame man, I'll heal you and then I'll pick you up and walk. Walk. Now, I'm not saying to you now, go up to someone and just say, walk. But just recognize that Jesus didn't do it your way or in your order. Right? So it's that whole thing of, hey, Lord, you are my Lord. You are my God. You are my way. You are the one who makes the mountain move, not me. Right? We are confident, yes, as we carry on reading. Well, please, rather to be absent from the body is to be present from the Lord. Great revelation here. Don't live your life for this earth because trust me, it's better after this earth. It's amazing. Don't fear your destination in Christ Jesus. It's amazing. Right? Okay? But then let's live this earth on purpose because he comes back to this earth. We make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to the Lord, not to people, not to our feelings, but to the Lord. Why? We all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, we've spoken about this. Your sin has been judged in Jesus. So when this life ends or the Lord returns, right, whatever happens first, you do not stand before Jesus to account for your sin. Because if you believe in Jesus, your sin has been removed, right? But you do stand before Jesus around reward. In other words, now, what did you do with the gospel preached to you? And he says here very clearly, each one may receive the things, a reward based on what you did in your business. No. In the gym. None of those things are bad things. But God has one priority. How did we function in the body? Look, were we fruitful in the body? Now, can I tell you something? In me, for me to be fruitful in the body is impossible by my flesh. Anyone who works with me, my wife who's married to me, my kids who hang around me, in my own flesh, I cannot be but toxic to the body. I come to work sometimes in such a bad mood, I bring it with me. Okay, fine. I'm the only person. Only person here, right? So the thing is, I already acknowledge for me to walk in fruitfulness in the body, I've just got to be more and more reliant on the Holy Spirit and more going, hey, I'm weak here, Lord. I can't do this. I have no faith in my flesh, but I'm still called to be fruitful by the Spirit, a fruit of the Spirit. I'm still called to walk a supernatural life. In fact, I believe as we do this more and more with the Lord, we literally are transformed. We are not the same person in 2020 that we were in 2019, right? And we're not the same person in 21 that we were in 2020. We keep growing. We keep maturing. We keep becoming fruitful. Why? Because God so wants to give us a supernatural reward that reveals how good God is. Pastor, what do you mean a supernatural reward that shows me in heaven how good God was? I'll give you a quick snapshot. The author of this scripture, Paul, spends the majority of his life serving Jesus in prison. We all know the famous story where him and Silas worship and the prison walls come down. But the majority of his life serving Jesus is when he worships and the prison cell stays intact. Okay, now he already has Holy Spirit insight that you receive a reward in heaven based on how effective you are in the body of Christ. Okay, so I'm not saying Paul did this, but I would go to the Lord like I've done about other things and said, this is lekker. For those of you in the Netherlands and everyone else, that's a South African statement for saying, this is great, sarcastically. Right? You have revealed to me that the goal here for my life is to be effective in the local church. Fantastic. Now I preach the gospel and I'm thrown in prison and the cell stays closed the majority of the time. You know, it's hard to preach the gospel to a lot of people in a prison. Because there's not a lot of people in your cell. Oh, let's just get practical here. There's not a lot of people in your cell. So Paul's like, if only I could be out of this cell, if only I could be in Rome, preaching to the Romans, in Ephesus, preaching to the Ephesians, in Corinth, preaching to the Corinthians, in Galatia, preaching to the, you get the theme. If only I wasn't limited, I could be more fruitful. And at some point in this process, Paul has to tap into the Holy Spirit because you can't be fruitful by the Spirit without yielding to the Spirit. And the Holy Spirit says, Paul, I understand your frustrations. I understand I've given you a word for a people. Write it down. How is this? Lord, how is this fruitful? Write it down. This is not a time on earth where there's cloud storage, security of information. No, it is a piece of paper thousands of years ago with writing on it, a letter. God, if only you let me out, I could be so effective. If only you released me, right? Fine, I'll write it down. Well, who knows how this is going to work? I'll just give it and let's hope it gets there. Let's hope it has any impact on those people. But if only I was there in person, I could have laid hands myself. I could have told them myself. I have such great things to tell those in Rome. There is no condemnation for those who are now in Christ Jesus. I can do all things, right? Greater is He. Man, I could tell them such great things. Who even knows if a letter is going to work? And you could imagine Paul getting to heaven and Jesus giving him his reward. And Paul going, now hang on a second. All right, I was quite fruitful. But what is all this? This is way, way, way more than I thought I deserved. And you can imagine, well, you followed the Holy Spirit and you wrote it down, right? Because how many of you would have been tempted to go, forget this, I'm in prison and until I'm out of prison, I'm not doing your work. Oh, just me. I'm not going to preach anymore until we have that building, until we have this budget met. Come on, everybody. You are limiting me. Lean into the Holy Spirit. What would you have me do? You can imagine, oh, this is, and God says, yeah, no, you know, I had to keep you in prison because you would have gone and preached and never written this down. And you see, there's billions of people there's Asian people and Indian people and South American people and Alaskan people and people who live in igloos and people who live in the Amazon forest. And they read these letters that you thought you wrote to 20 people and it led to them believing in Jesus. And that is added to your account in your reward. And billions and billions and billions of people have come to faith in me through that obedience. Wow. He wouldn't be standing in heaven going, how good am I? He would be going, how good is my God? How faithful is my God? How my perspective was so short-sighted. If only I would have seen what the Holy Spirit was doing, I never would have left the prison cell. I'd have just written and written and written. Do you know what I mean? You go to the other side. Okay, hang on a second. On the other side of your obedience, God has just an overflow of His abundance and the devil comes and he says, that path is never going to move the mountain. And you have no idea. You know, one of the things I've seen about God is He doesn't do it our way, but He also does it better than we. Like, in other words, I have always put a box around what my mountain moving is, but sometimes there's roots and there's, like, you know what I mean? We're okay with good. We're okay with like partial, you know, we have no idea how good God is. And when He does it, how perfect it is. How redemption is so much better than what we ever thought. We drove past this building so often and we never thought in our wildest dreams this was actually something possible. Now, it's not about the building, but it was like our chase. We went off to 50 other places. We would have settled for, I would have. Tara's nodding because she told me that's not God. I said, so cross with her. But our church has no space. It has no space. We have to. And she's like, that's not God. That's not a nice place. That's a total compromise. And I'd be like, but that's all we have. It's not about a building, you know. And you know what, Pastor, why are we always talking about, hey, we want to do this. We want to do that. We want to alter. We want to make space. You know, when Jesus was ministering, there was a house that was jammed full of people. And yet people still made a way to get a lame person to Jesus's feet. What happened? Right? They literally altered the structure. First, it was an illegal renovation, but the first renovation we've ever seen in Scripture to get as many people to Jesus as possible. Why? Because he showed up a paraplegic and he left healed and whole. It's always about making more space for Jesus to move, for Jesus to touch, for more sons and daughters to come home, right? To be reached. And how Paul could have just said, this is not my plan, it's not my way. And it's so funny, see, it's so cross to Tara. You know, nothing like your spouse to tell you truth, but you just didn't want to hear it from your spouse. You know, we're going to swing for the fences and we're going to lean on the Holy Spirit and we are going to believe for a sea of people to be saved. Because that's the promise in Scripture over us, the bride of Christ. The gospel will be preached to us and the gospel is going to flow from us and through us. If you're the only person in your family that believes in Jesus, hey, I've got news for you. Watch out. So many people in your family, right? You're the only person in your office that believes. You're the only person that declares the promises. Hey, it's all God needs to work. It's all God needs. That's all God needs to see him do a supernatural, exceedingly abundantly above all work in Jesus' name. Wow, wasn't that an incredible word? I know that even listening to that for myself, I can hear how God is already with us and went ahead of us into this year. Maybe you're watching right now and you've never declared Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. I'm not asking you about, are you religious or have you been raised in church or ever attended church before? I'm specifically asking you a question. Have you ever prayed to give your life into the hands of Jesus as your Savior, as your Lord? For all of us at Redemption Church and the broader Christian church, this is a key decision. It's not a decision to choose a religion. It's actually about depending on Jesus as your Lord and Savior. So right now, right here, I want to pray a prayer, the prayer of salvation with you. If you've never prayed this prayer before and you're watching, wherever you're watching, whenever you're watching, pray this prayer. Declare Christ your Lord and Savior. Walk into a new life with him. Repeat after me, say, Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Thank you, Jesus. You shed your blood. Your body was broken so that I could be made whole. Born again, a precious, righteous, perfect child of God. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. If you prayed that prayer right here, right now, for the first time, below, wherever you're watching, whether you're watching on YouTube, Facebook, you can comment and say, I prayed for the first time, or simply go to our website. The information is up below. And let us know that you just prayed to be a new believer so that we can send you a whole bunch of online resources, a gift from us to you as you begin this journey with Jesus as your Lord and Savior. We're going to receive communion together right now. Wherever you're watching, we're going to put our eyes on Jesus, whichever home you're in, whichever place you're in, get some bread. Because this is about bringing the power of what Jesus did on the cross 2,000 years ago into the now, into this moment. So take this bread, this wafer with you, wherever you are with your families right now. We're going to speak healing and wholeness into our bodies and into our homes. Take the body of Jesus and repeat after me, say, this is the body of Jesus that was broken for me. I declare by his sacrifice, by his suffering, Jesus made me healed. Jesus made me whole. Today I declare my body be healed and whole in Jesus' name. Now we break and we receive his body into our bodies, we receive his healing for us in our homes. Healing is ours in Jesus' name. Healing reigns in our homes, in our lives, in our bodies. Symptoms must bow their knee to Jesus and his sacrifice in Jesus' name. If you can just take the juice, the liquid in your house right now, whatever you have, we're going to speak over this and say, this is the blood of Jesus shed for me. Today I declare, I'm righteous, I'm perfect, I am whole because of what Jesus has done at the cross for me. Now we receive. Amen, amen. I want to speak for a moment to all of you who are part of Redemption Church about financial prosperity. I'm not talking about getting rich. I'm talking about seeing the supernatural provision that God brings into our lives. See, God knows that we have need. In fact, God understands that we would have need and that we would be in need here on earth. And he doesn't like it that we live in need, but that God so desires to show you that he doesn't just love you to remove your sin. He doesn't just love you to give you healing and wholeness. He also loves you to walk with you into financial provision, that he would be your provider, that he would take care of you. In this moment now more than ever, we need to tell people about the goodness of the provision of God, and we need to place our faith in Jesus for our provision. I know that as a church, we are not forceful on people about finance, but we certainly are full of faith when it comes to who is our provider. And I want to encourage you to make sure that your faith is in Jesus. However you give, wherever you give in this ministry, however it's online or through Zapper or SnapScan, I just want to encourage you, connect your faith for provision to God, not a government, not an economy, not a job. So we believe in the tithe. We don't believe in it done out of manipulation, but by revelation. We don't believe it's done by fear, but actually in faith. In response to the goodness of our God, today we declare over each and every single person watching that we give in faith that Jesus is our provider. And although the world is in crisis and in famine, the Bible talks over and over and over again about the world being in famine, but the children of God found prosperity, found provision. Even in the desert, manna by day, we notice that they would wake up to food, that they would wake up to provision. God wants us not to go out and stress and work and earn it. He wants to be our provider by his work, by his effort. So as we receive of your tithe and offering today, I want to encourage you, God is your provider. We declare in every home, in every household, in every life today, financial provision. As we give of our tithe, as we give of our offerings in response to the Holy Spirit, I thank you, Jesus. You are our provider. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for partnering with us, sowing into what we're doing and being a part of church. We pray you're blessed. We'll see you again next week at church. Be blessed.
Oh my goodness, Mika, I'm so pumped. I'm so amped. I'm still excited that to know that even in this pandemic, God is still a God who moves mountains. What an awesome reminder. Thank you, Pastor Josh, for sharing that word with us.
We really needed that reminder, Mpo. So I just want to encourage you right now. You might be sitting there thinking, when is God going to move my mountain? Has God forsaken me? Has God forgotten about me? I need to tell you that he has not.
Come on.
He has not. He is with you. He has the power.
Indeed.
And he will move the mountains in your life.
Yes, it's so awesome. And if you have said the salvation prayer today with us, we want to welcome you into the bride of Christ. You know, heavens is celebrating. We're celebrating. We're saying welcome. It's so awesome to have you join us on this journey.
It really is. And we just want to let you know that we do have some free new believers content available on our website to help you along this journey. So go and check that out.
Indeed. You know, we have amazing kids church content.
Yeah.
You know, if you haven't checked it out, you can go still on our Facebook page, Redemption Kids, or YouTube Redemption Kids as well, mm-hmm. even on their Instagram, and you can check out their content so the little ones can also have a Sunday experience.
I think it's important that the little ones do have a Sunday experience. You know, us adults are struggling through this time. Who knows what is actually happening to our gorgeous children? Why not let them also feed on the word in something that they can actually relate to?
Indeed. The Kids Church content is actually so awesome. It's so awesome.
Yeah. Just a reminder that we do have our Gracious Daughters event that will be taking place on the 28th of August. You can actually go and register.
Yes, registration is open as of today. So just hop onto the website below and register.
Yes, you can. And also please do go and follow us on Facebook and on Instagram if you would like to stay up to date.
Indeed.
So, Paul, after all of that excitement, we've said a lot of words today, I think.
Indeed.
Right? Can I ask you to say one final word and close us out in prayer?
Sure, no problem. Yeah, so I mean, I just want to encourage you. You know, God is still working. Mountains are still being moved. You know, it's not by might nor by power, but by His Spirit. So be encouraged today. I know I'm encouraged very much so by the word that we heard today. And let's just take a moment, bow our heads, close our eyes, you know, and lift up that mountain to Jesus. You know, look to Jesus as we pray right now. Lord, we thank You that You're such a great God, that You're a God that still moves mountains, even in the midst of a pandemic, Father God, that You're still on the throne, that You're still in control, Father God. We thank You right now for whatever anyone is facing online right now. We pray, bring it before You, Father God. Say, move those mountains in Jesus' name, Father God. We thank You for such a beautiful time in Your presence as a church, Father God, online, Father God. We thank You that You are still working, Father God. There's never distance in the Spirit. We give You all the honor and glory and praise, Father God, as we walk into this week with boldness, with confidence that our God is still in control. Our God is still moving mountains. We thank You in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. I love it, Paul. Thank you.
Have a beautiful week. See you next week.
See you next week, guys.
Hey, come on, let's sing. Oh, death could not hold.